Hi there. This is the Canal Arbitragem, arbitration channel, and this is part of our program, Think Tank HardTalk. And today we are going to interview Gabrielle Kaufmann-Kohler. Gabrielle Kaufmann-Kohler is Honorary President of ICCA, the International Council for Commercial Arbitration. She practices international, commercial, investment, and sports arbitration. And Gabrielle appears on numerous institutional arbitration panels like ICC, ICSID, AAA, LCIA, SIAC, and CIETAC. She's a professor emerita at Geneva University Law School and honorary president of the Swiss Arbitration Association. And I have three or four pages of her curriculum, and I'm not going to read this. Gabrielle, this is only to introduce you to our young practitioners and to our students. It's a real pleasure to have you in order to record this interview. And the program, you know, is the objective of this program is to make some questions in order to give to our students and to our young practitioners an idea of who is who in the world of arbitration and who is important in the world of arbitration. So, first of all, let's start with Fabiana and to make some questions.
Thank you, Professor Carmona. Professor Gabrielle, first of all, thank you so much for being here with us. It's an amazing honor for us and for all the Brazilian arbitration community to hear you and to learn from you. So, first of all, we would really like to know when and how did you start working with arbitration?
Maybe before I answer this, should I say that I'm very happy to be at least virtually in Brazil today. It would be much nicer to be there in real, but that's not the times we live in now. So thank you very much for having me. I did a PhD in private international law many, many years ago. And that was I liked anything that was linked to different countries and was open to the world. And then when I got to practicing and asked myself, well, where can I do something that is international? And arbitration looked like a good candidate for that. And so when I went for 2 years to New York, that was 1981. And my first arbitration I worked on was at 81. So it's 40 years ago. So I feel very, very, very old. But I asked when I was in this firm as a foreign associate whether I could work on arbitration. And I was allowed to work on my first arbitration. And that is when I started. And I learned a lot during these times. And I liked it very much. So when I came back to Switzerland later, I try to develop arbitration work. So that's how it started.
That's amazing. And there was, from then until now, there was a lot of development and growth. And there's a study of investment arbitration released in 2016 that concluded that you were the most influential arbitrator in the world. So we would really like to know, how did you enter the investment arbitration world and what do you enjoy most about working in international arbitration?
Yeah, I think it must have been early 2000s when I was put on the arbitrator list of the World Bank chairman. There are investment arbitrators that are designated by states, parties to the ICSID convention, and there's a special list that is drawn up by the chairman. And I was lucky enough to get put on this list. And then I was also lucky that two more senior arbitrators were bold enough or maybe supportive enough to choose me as president of the arbitral tribunal. This was Caroline Spock-Stiegel and Bernardo Crevades. And so that was my first investment arbitration. It was, I remember it vividly, it was Aucoven, Autopistas Concedidas de Venezuela against Venezuela. And so so that is how it started, and I liked it very much. It was tough because I was chairing, and it was my first investment arbitration with two senior arbitrators, much more experienced than I was, but they were nice to me, and I did my best, and then the other appointments followed afterwards. So yeah, that's the start. I think you asked another question after that, didn't you?
What do you enjoy most about working in international arbitration?
Yeah, that's a good question. There's many things I like in international arbitration. I already said that I liked what is open to the world, where I can learn about other countries, other cultures. It's very diverse because every arbitration is like a story that is told to me, right? Where with different cast of characters, with a different economic sector, with specific facts, with certain legal issues. So I like this very much. I like the transnational culture of international arbitration, where you mix people from different backgrounds. What else do I like? I like, as an arbitrator, I like chairing a lot because it is, well, you have to resolve the disputes in terms of facts and law, but you also have to manage the process, and you have to manage the people. You have to manage counsel, witnesses, experts, and then you also have to manage the tribunal. And that is often behind the scenes and people don't see it, but it's also part of the work. So all of this is a very mixed type of activity that I enjoy very much.
Thank you. It's very nice to hear this from you, and I relate to it, so it's really nice. And Professor, my last question in this topic would be, do you recall any arbitration that made a particular impression on you or had a marked effect on your career, besides the first one, or maybe even that one?
Yeah, there are so many, so it's difficult to single out. And of course, they all add up to my experience. But it's true that the first investment arbitration remains an important one for me, because I somehow discovered a whole new world. It was very different from commercial arbitration, not the technique. The techniques are dispute resolution. They're the same largely, but this was a different game because, I suppose, mainly because of the public interest that is involved, and then gives a different flavor to the dispute settlement. So that was really a discovery for me, and I enjoyed it very much.
Gabrielle, you were talking about culture in arbitration, and this is something that you like most in arbitration. But dealing with different cultures is something very, very difficult in commercial arbitration, especially in commercial arbitration, isn't it? I'm asking this question because we are Brazilian and we are very friendly, informal, and well, you know, because you know Brazil, you know us. Brazilians. Is this disturbing for international arbitration and for commercial arbitration, for instance, dealing with this Brazilian culture, for instance?
No, it isn't. I have had some international arbitrations in Brazil, and it was not disturbing at all. It was quite pleasant, I would say. I mean, the work is always hard, right? And you have to work and you have to understand the facts and you have to understand the law. But this friendly environment, that friendly atmosphere makes things easier. And when I chair, I always try to make sure that the atmosphere is friendly and nice, because sometimes it can be very aggressive, and depending on how you chair, you can kind of neutralize the aggressions, and then it becomes easier. It's easier for the tribunal because you focus on the issues and not on all kinds of side battles. And I think it's nicer for counsel as well, because they can also focus on what is important. So to me, when at the end of the hearing, I have a feeling like everyone has the feeling that they were heard. Well, someone may well lose, right? Sometimes both lose, but sometimes one loses. But the fact that at the hearing they got the feeling that they were treated fairly, to me that's very important, and that's part also of this whole more friendly, cooperative way of handling proceedings.
Good, thank you. And now Sergio is going to ask some questions about arbitration in Brazil. Sergio.
Thank you, Carmona. First of all, thank you very much, Professor Gabrielle, for being with us today. It's such an honor to interview you and to learn from you and your large experience. So the questions that I have is related to arbitration in Brazil. And the first one that I would say is, if you had an opportunity of participating in arbitrations involving Brazilian parties or Brazilian law, which you already answered. So my question would be, what was the experience that you had working in this case?
It was two international commercial arbitrations, was in part Brazilian parties, Brazilian counsel, arbitrators, a lot of people in the room. In the end, frankly, it was not that different from an arbitration proceedings in Paris or in London or in Singapore or in New York, because we by now have and I think everywhere in international arbitration, common ways of doing things. And so that was, it was not unknown. The way the procedure evolved was very much the ways I was familiar with. In general, I was struck by how lively the Brazilian arbitration scene is. There's lots of people participating, there's a lot of activity, and I've seen this in these arbitrations, but I've seen it on other occasions as well. I mean, it struck me last time I spoke in person at a conference in Sao Paulo, it was at CAM. It also was very evident when we organized the ICCA Congress in Rio, that's a little older, that was in 2010. There was such an interest and such a lively community that is very impressive for people who come from small countries like me, you know.
Yeah, that's great. By working on these cases, did you form any particular view about arbitration in Brazil?
Now I have to speak under the control of all those who know it so much better than I do. That is a little risky to answer this. No, I was struck, but I knew this from research I had done, that there is a more conciliatory approach to arbitration, at least traditionally in Brazil, and it's similar to what we have in Switzerland or in Germany is as well the same thing. Interestingly, it's the same thing in China. So, and other places that are more common law traditions have less of this conciliation approach. I think, if I'm not mistaken, in your arbitration law, there's a specific provision that the tribunal must attempt to conciliate the parties. And that is something that was very familiar to me and would be very awkward to an English arbitrator, for instance.
Yes, it's something very common that we have usually in Brazil, not only in arbitration, but also in judicial cases, that conciliation or mediation must be tried before the proceeding. So that's very
cool. Linked, actually, because if courts do it, then arbitral tribunals also generally do it, at least traditionally. And in other places where courts don't do it, arbitrators think that their only role is to settle the dispute by issuing a decision as opposed to getting parties to settle. Yeah.
Great. Okay, thank you.
Sure.
It is part of our tradition, I would say. This is why in our arbitration law, we have this recommendation to the arbitrators that they try to conciliate parties or to make a mediation, which sounds a little awkward to foreigners, because arbitrator is not a mediator, but well, the arbitrators are not going to act as mediator. And I think you have this experience in Brazil, because you have a very famous arbitration you are chairing here in Sao Paulo, if I'm not mistaken. And it ended with a conciliation, and it was a very, very difficult case. Perhaps you were a very stern arbitrator and the lawyers were afraid of you. So this is why they tried to mediate. Okay, so now Gustavo is making some questions about diversity.
Hi, Professor Gabriel. Thanks for being with us today. It's a great pleasure to have you here. Yeah, like Professor Carmona said, our third part of this interview is about diversity. It's a very challenging topic. The first question is this one. Did you face difficulties in your career being a female? And what was your role model to pursue your career considering diversity?
When I in my younger years in arbitration, I would really have liked to have a role model, right? Someone I could look up to, who would be an inspiration. But as a woman, I saw no one with whom I could identify. And I was a woman with small children and a family to manage and a professional life next to it. And the ones who were specializing in arbitration didn't fit this model, so eventually I had to decide that I had to do it my way and try to be myself and do my best like this. So yeah. Did you ask whether I had
difficulties in your career being familiar?
Yeah, I certainly did, and maybe I did not always realize it on the spot, but maybe later thinking back, I thought, well, maybe I was not appointed in this arbitration because to chair this arbitration because I was a woman. But then I try not to focus too much on these issues. And it is true also that I have had support from, I mentioned it earlier on, but I have also had, I came across arbitrators who were much more senior than I was, with whom I had the privilege of working together, and they were very supportive to me and they helped my career. So you have actually both a little bit, yeah. You have the discrimination part and the support part. Yeah.
Perfect.
This has changed, I think. I hope it has changed over the years.
And how important do you think it is, diversity of age, gender, ethnic, cultural diversity in general in international arbitration?
I think it plays a very important role in the acceptability of international arbitration as a dispute resolution mechanism. And I worked on this more in the context of investment arbitration, where We have a lot of statistics about all this issue of legitimacy of the international arbitration, and diversity plays a role there. But it's the same in commercial arbitration. And to me, diversity is really many different aspects. And I think you mentioned, gender, of course, is one, but that is improving. I see it improving more and more with good awareness now that gender diversity should be promoted. But then there is also regional diversity. And when I say regional, I use it in a broad fashion. This covers race, it covers ethnicity, it covers religion, it covers culture. And that still is there's a lot of work to be done there, I think, because, and I always tell my students, when I have students here who come from all parts of the world, I say, well, it's good that you come here and learn and get some experience, but then go back and practice arbitration in your jurisdiction, because it's important that we develop more and more diversity, regional diversity. There's age as well. Age is a little bit more complicated because obviously experience requires time, which means that if you take time, you get older, right? So that is a little different, although I see that there are many young people who are very good at it, who are very hardworking. And sometimes I think if I were counsel, maybe I would rather take just a big name. I would maybe take someone who's a little younger and would still prove what he's capable of doing. And that might be a better deal for the party. So age is a factor too that should be considered more.
Yeah, I was going to ask specifically this question about age now, but you have already answered. But just to make out my last one here, what do you think about of the appointment of younger arbitrators? And by younger arbitrators, I mean individuals in their 30s. But specifically to solve disputes that are of lower economic value, for example, maybe sometimes they can act as sole arbitrators. Do you think this would be, you know, fine, good, or, and do you know about any recent developments in the global context in this regard?
I see this happening more and more because institutions try to appoint younger people, also to renew the pool. And I think that's good practice because we have to make space. I mean, older people like me have to make space for younger ones. And there's a rare longevity among arbitrators, right, which you don't find in that many professions. And which is good in some aspects, but also sometimes makes it more difficult for younger people to get to appointments where they have serious responsibilities. So I think that's a good practice, and institutions do this more and more, and that gives an opportunity for younger people to gain experience, which is often the difficult part of it, is getting your first appointment to show you're capable of doing it, and then the others will follow.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor.
Sure.
And we are trying to do this in Brazil, Gabrielle. There are some institutions that work with lists of arbitrators, and we try to put those youngsters, those that are prepared in this lists of this institution, so that in the low economic value cases they can work. And we are doing a best profit of these youngsters because they are really very well prepared. And in these arbitrations that are some simple, I would say, they try to do their best. So the final result is fantastic. because they want to show they are very good and, yeah, they are prepared. So it's a good experience. At least here in Brazil, the results are very good. And now, Fabi, again, the arbitration, the arbitrator and the law. This is the topic. Fabi.
Thank you, Professor. Professor Gabrielle, what an arbitrator should do when dealing with a law unknown to her or him, especially regarding a lot of your experience with international arbitrations, and also if in this context, what is the importance of Uranoft Arbiter to international arbitration?
Years ago, I wrote an article and I gave speeches about this, and I counted how many times I actually applied laws that I did not know, and the vast majority of my cases were in laws that I do not know. So that is certainly a specificity of arbitration compared to court litigation. It seems to me that a good legal mind can master this. You have a lot of help as an arbitrator. You have counsel submissions. You often have legal experts. You have legal authorities that you have to study. You can ask questions. So once you have absorbed all this, I think you should be able to give a solution in a law that in which you are not trained. Maybe what happens is maybe you miss some peculiarities or idiosyncrasies of a specific legal system, and you tend to make things more uniform or more harmonized because you think in your legal system, even though I don't often apply Swiss law, that's my basic education. So maybe my references are to notions in Swiss law. So that may be different I have tried to analyze this years ago, but it's difficult to really pinpoint to what extent an arbitral tribunal on a given legal issue in a specific legal system gives a different decision than what a local court would do. In the end, I don't think it makes much of a difference, but it's still an open issue. There's this harmonization thing about arbitration, which comes from the fact that you have people who do not know the law and reason in a more general way. I don't know whether that answers your question.
Yes, no, that's perfect. And I'll jump to another one, and then maybe I'll come back to another issue about Uranoved Arbiter. You've mentioned about your interest on international, transnational process and arbitration. So what do you think nowadays about the globalization of arbitration procedure? And is this a reality or a myth?
Yeah, I think it's a reality. It's a fact. Think about witness statements. When I started 40 years ago, that was not at all an accepted practice, right? Some arbitrators would say you have to give a witness statement. Others would not. Others would have just direct examination, like in some courts you have, where the witnesses come and then you ask them just questions and then they say, yeah, I remember this or I don't remember that. Today, in international arbitration, we find it quite natural to have witness statements, to not have long direct examinations, but just short ones and then cross-examination. So I think I could give many more examples of that. So there is a clear trend that we see and we have seen now for a number of decades. That does not mean that everything is the same everywhere. And so when one arbitrates in one seat under one law, I would say you always have to make sure that you have read the arbitration law of the place and you're not missing something that would be important and might give rise to risk of annulment.
Thank you, that's perfect. And then going back to another point, you have written about iure novit arbiter in international arbitration. Do you think that the Prague rules are good guidance concerning this issue? And is this something that is accepted in international arbitration or courts around the world, or is there still a resistance to iure novit arbiter?
There are still differences in legal traditions. I remember that's a long time ago. I remember one co-arbitrator saying during the deliberation, well, they have not proven the law. And I was relatively ignorant at that time, and I was saying, well, why are you saying this? They don't have to prove the law. We are the ones who apply the law. We prove the facts. We don't prove the law. But I mean, in his tradition, the parties had to prove the law because the law was foreign law compared to what he knew. And so it was just natural that you have to prove the law. So there are different approaches to that in court and in arbitration. In part, still there are differences. Now, I usually have a standard provision in my initial procedural documents that say that the parties will explain what the law, what the legal rules are, and if the tribunal wants, it can do its own research into the law, but it has no obligation to do so. And that is precisely to avoid difficulties in jurisdictions where the tribunal should not venture into its own investigations. But what is important, I think, is what matters most is that you don't surprise the parties with the application of a rule that they didn't argue and were given no opportunity to comment on. So I would always make sure that this opportunity is given to the parties. If they have not pleaded something and I think it's relevant, then I would ask them, what do you think about it? The Prague rules, I think you mentioned the Prague rules. The difficulty with the Prague rules is that they are taking quite a civil law approach to international arbitration. And they may be fine in certain cultural legal contexts and not in others. And when you have a real a party from a civil law country, one from a more common law country, then they're not well adapted. And I think they say that the tribunal can apply a rule ex officio, a legal rule ex officio, if the arbitrators are qualified in that legal system. And then they also say that you have to ask the parties to comment. I don't think you have to be qualified in a legal system to apply a rule that the parties have not specifically pleaded, because most of the time, you have at least one arbitrator who doesn't know that legal system. So that reduces the scope very much. I would rather place the emphasis on the fact that you should not surprise the parties was a rule that they didn't expect. Does that answer
Yes, or that's perfect.
Something.
Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, it does.
That's good.
Yes, it does. But Gabrielle, we are dealing with a very risky system, isn't it? Because let's suppose that we have to apply the Swedish law, for instance. Even if you ask the parties to prove the law, you don't speak Swedish, so you are not going to be able to make any research and to understand exactly what the law means. So perhaps you are going to surprise the parties at the end of the day. Perhaps you are going to apply that law in a completely different way, not because you want to contradict a tribunal, for instance, but because you can understand law. So at the end of the day, I think this is a very risky system. If you are going to adjudicate according to a law that you do not know, if you know the language, at least it's okay. So you're going to make your research. But if you are supposed to apply the Chinese law, by God, perhaps you are going to cause a wonderful surprise or a tragedy to the parties. I don't know. But I think in Brazil, we are discussing this, the system, and we are discussing this jura novit curia because it's part of our tradition, and we don't have a conclusion. So it's very interesting to understand your position and to discuss it later. Thank you very much for this opinion. And now it is it's João's time. So your turn.
Thank you, Professor Carmona. Thank you, Professor Gabrielle, for being here today. It's a pleasure for all of us. And I'd like to follow up one issue that Professor Carmona brought early today about different cultures. So Professor Carmona said and commented about this issue of dealing with lawyers from different cultures. So the $1 million question or the millions and millions of dollars question would be how to reconcile as an arbitrator working with lawyers from civil and common law jurisdictions.
That's one of the beauties of arbitration, right? That bridges the gaps and it merges procedural cultures. And it does so not in a theoretical way, but it does so in practice. So it does so in a way that you have to reach a result, which is an award. And for that, everybody needs to work together. And you have, as an arbitrator, to make sure that the framework is such that everybody understands what is being done, that the procedure is predictable, that nobody has bad surprises. Many, many years ago, I remember I was counsel then, and I had been trained in New York. So it was obvious to me that it was in Switzerland. The arbitration was seated in Switzerland. It was obvious to me that I could meet the parties, the witnesses in advance and not prepare that testimony, but work on them and say, this could be a question. And you should go back to your notes and please refresh your recollection before you come to the hearing and so on. And my opponent was a local lawyer who had probably experience in domestic arbitration and not much in international arbitration. And at some point he made an incident and said, this is not possible. They know all the answers to the questions that she asks. There must be some collusion, some conspiracy between them or so. And I said, what's wrong with this, right? And thanks God, I had arbitrators who were familiar with the international practice and thought that it was nothing wrong. But it shows that what you want to avoid this type of surprises. And in fact, unequal treatment because the other counsel had never met with the witnesses and he had no clue what they would answer to his questions. That would have been the way you do it, and you would have done it in court in this system. But it would not be the way it would be done in international arbitration. So these are misunderstandings that you want to avoid. And for that, you have to be aware of the differences in culture, and then you have to address them. And the best way is to address them in a straightforward manner and set procedural rules that are understood by everyone.
Absolutely. And since we are from a civil law jurisdiction, and as Brazilians, we are way used to commercial arbitration. So we don't have a lot of experience in investment arbitration. So you just mentioned about this different flavor of international of investment arbitration. So what are, in your view, the basic differences between investment arbitrations and commercial arbitration? So what is this different flavor that you just mentioned early before?
A good part of the discussion that we had before about not knowing the law falls away in investment arbitration because you apply mostly, not exclusively, but mostly international law and the treaty standards. So that makes a difference. It's important in investment arbitration also that you have an understanding for the functioning of a state in legal proceeding, especially in legal proceedings, but not only, because the state's way of handling the arbitration may involve all kinds of different ministries, agencies, different authorities, central authority, provincial authorities, and the like. And that will reduce its speed of action compared to a private actor who has a CEO, and you can ask the CEO to make the decision or the general counsel, and they will make a decision. So that is more of a practical difficulty. What else is there? It's clear that the awards are all published, or practically all published. Sometimes the proceedings are public as well. So, and one says the awards have no precedential value. That's the rule. But in real fact, parties argue based on prior awards a lot. And so you have to consider them as a tribunal. And you have always a concern that what you are saying in this arbitration will resolve this dispute, but may have unintended consequences in other disputes, because people will look at your award and maybe not understand it like you meant it, or it was really shaped for this case or these facts. This wouldn't apply generally. So there's this systemic aspect of investment arbitration that makes it more complex, I would say, to make decisions. Because in commercial arbitration, you have two parties. They have negotiated a contract. That's a one-off contract very often, not always, but very often. And you give a ruling with respect to this contract, these parties, these facts. In investment arbitration, the treaties are often have similar standards, or sometimes even identical language. And so the issues are very much recurrent. I mean, what is fair and equitable treatment? What is an expropriation? And so these are always the same issues. Now you can say, of course, that the language is not exactly the same, and there's a comma there, and there's no comma there. But the general issues are the same, and therefore you're more aware of the systemic aspect. I mean, some arbitrators will tell you that they're not at all, because they consider their mission is just to resolve this dispute, and they don't look at any other consequences that their decision may have. I think that's a little bit more complicated than that, because even if you don't want it, people will quote your award later on. So I don't know whether that answers the differences. I'm sure there are many others, but I would have to think harder.
No, it was really good. So I couldn't agree more. Now I defer to Professor Carmona.
Thank you. Well, our next topic is the risk of annulment. And Gustavo.
Professor, before moving to the risk of annulment, I would like to ask one more question regarding culture, the diversity of cultures in international arbitration. It's a quick question. How useful, Professor Gabriel, do you think are the soft laws in arbitration?
There are some soft laws that are extremely valuable in practice. If you think of especially the IBA rules on taking of evidence, they have become almost hard law. But globalized hard law, because even if the parties don't choose them, many international tribunals would look to them when they make the decisions. Maybe the IBA guidelines on conflicts of interest are also, I would not make a decision on a difficult issue of disclosure without checking there whether I should disclose or not. So there are some soft laws that are very, very useful. Yes. Yeah.
Perfect. Now moving to the risk of annulment topic.
Yes.
The first question would be, there is this expression very known, due process paranoia. And do you think there is a due process paranoia? This theme is real?
Yeah, I don't know. When I conduct an arbitration, I never lose sight of the risk of annulment, right? It's always in the back of my mind when I give a ruling during a hearing, for instance, because if there is an incident, I always think, watch out, because maybe you're now making a mistake and that could give rise to an annulment. So it's always there. I'm not sure about the paranoia thing. There is an important distinction between an arbitral tribunal and a court, right? A court has, in Latin, imperium. It has this. It has the backing of the state, and it can impose things on parties, whether they like it or not. An arbitrator is in a more vulnerable position. Of course, there is an arbitration law that allows him to impose things, but if you want the arbitration to move smoothly, you somehow, as an arbitrator, rely on the cooperation of the party. Because if a party wants to obstruct the arbitration, there's many different ways of doing it. You will nevertheless get to the award, but it may take longer and it may be more difficult. And it may be more risky in terms of annulment as well. So an arbitrator is naturally inclined to make sure that there is no strong objection or strong resistance. If it has to come to it, then you will make a decision, even if it's unpleasant for one party. But if you can avoid it, I think it's better. And is that due process paranoia, or just is it a way of being efficient by not creating obstacles? Probably there's a little bit of both there.
Right. And in your experience, how persuasive are the parties' claims on risk of annulment in the tribunal's decision-making?
I remember one situation where a party said, this is a due process violation. And I said, yes, you're probably right. And I need to change this decision. And I refused you this opportunity and I'm going to give it to you. But that was really an exception. Usually it's more like threats and so, and an experienced arbitrator knows these things. So you would have to pay attention yourself and not wait for someone to tell you now you're breaching due process. Avoiding breaches of due process is like a second nature, right? As an arbitrator, you're always paying attention to this.
Okay. Thank you so much, Professor.
Sure.
The next up is arbitration and the future. Now, the crystal ball. So, Sergio, it's your turn.
Thanks. Professor Gabriele, so talking about arbitration in the future, the first question is, in your experience, do you think that national courts are getting to know international arbitration better and have been less likely to review arbitral awards?
I may be a little biased here because I come from a jurisdiction where the courts very rarely quash an award. And sometimes you even think here they could have annulled and they didn't annul. And that's just because there is a philosophy that if the parties have chosen arbitration, they should be bound by it, by the pleasant and by the unpleasant consequences of their choice. So that's where I come from if I think of my home jurisdiction. Now, I think you haven't said it. You have asked the question, but maybe there was an implied statement there. I think courts in the world in general understand arbitration better than they did decades ago. In various places, there have been specialized courts or specialized chambers set up to deal with arbitration issues. There's a lot of educational effort made towards judges to explain, for instance, what the New York Convention is, what the grounds are, how it should be interpreted, and things like that. And judges generally, I mean, are very very open and interested in understanding this. So probably we have made progress in this respect over the last decades. It's also because there's more arbitration activity. So obviously these cases that may have been very rare in the past come up more often in courts.
That's great. It's interesting that you mentioned specialized chambers, because here in Brazil, São Paulo city is one of the most common seats for arbitration cases. And in São Paulo, we have specialized chambers in the upper court level since about 2010. And it's about 5 years that the São Paulo court have created also specialized judges in the trial court level. So we have very skilled judges to deal with this case and to deal with vacation awards proceedings. And I can say by experience that it's very rare the case in which the courts in Brazil annul the awards. And in case that it happened, it's usually when it's found that an arbitrator was biased. But just side comment. So moving to the second question, this topic, Professor, what do you think is the greatest challenge for international arbitration nowadays?
Yeah, that's a difficult question. I speak now of commercial arbitration, right? I think efficiency time and cost efficiency is a challenge. It's not a new challenge. It's been here for a long time, but it's ever present, and we all need to work on being as efficient as possible. Institutions have been very good at it in trying to promote fast track and summary proceedings and emergency arbitration and the like, and trying to speed up the processes. But that is a challenge which we should not forget. That may be also a reason why slowly we see more mediation, right, and more emphasis on mediation, because mediation is a very very efficient tool. Transparency may be a challenge too in arbitration, even in commercial arbitration, and that has a different facets. There's publication of awards. I think that we should work on more, because that assists the development of the law, and a lot of commercial law issues never get to the courts, and there are interesting solutions being worked out in arbitration, and they are not made public, or not enough made public. There's also a transparency with respect to the operation of arbitral institutions. Depends on the countries, but in some countries, I think it would be good that there is more insight into the workings of the institution, because it has it enhances the transparency, enhances good governance, and I think that's also important in fostering the confidence of users in arbitration. And then we've already mentioned diversity, but that is another challenge that has to be worked on. Yeah,
that's very interesting. Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor.
Sure.
So, happily, we arrived to the last topic of our interview, but this is one of the most important topics, and the interviewers are very interested in your advices to young professionals. So, João, your questions.
Thank you, Professor Carmona. So, Professor Gabriel, what a huge part of our of the people who are watching this interview would like to know is how, or better say, what advice would you give to young professionals who are seeking a career as an arbitrator?
Well, first do it if you enjoy it, because we're good at what we like to do, right? And otherwise you should not do it. Probably what is useful is a good education in international arbitration, maybe also in a different legal system, so that you develop a sensitivity for the fact that there are other ways of resolving or looking at things than the one you've initially been trained in. An open mind is also important for an arbitrator. You should really keep your mind open. Do not decide too fast. Really be listen. Hard work is unfortunately difficult to avoid, because it's the same for counsel and for arbitrators, obviously, but cases become more and more heavy in terms of facts, in terms of submissions, reports, materials. So you have to absorb all this, and that that simply means work. What else could I say? Maybe one should remain self-critical, right? And always try to improve. There's always room for improvement. So, yeah, that's what I would say. I'm sure there are other things that
A little bit of luck as well. I think it's another thing to consider. And maybe the one last question, on the very last question, is regarding submissions. So written and oral arguments. We are also lawyers who work in international or in domestic arbitrations, in litigation as well. So what tips would you give to young lawyers with regard to written and oral submissions?
I mean, there are no magical recipes, of course, but clarity to me is, as an arbitrator, when I read submissions or I listen to oral argument, clarity in the line of argumentation and in the way of and in expression as well is really important. Conciseness is also effective, I would say. Sometimes I have the feeling that counsel overestimate arbitrators. They're just human beings. They can absorb so much, and after a while, they don't absorb it anymore. So if you can be effective in communicating, conveying your main points, and if you can, it's not always possible, but if you can, throughout the proceedings, stick with your strategy, that is effective as well, I would say. I saw some very good counsel who kept saying the same three arguments. And then you think, well, you know, these are good arguments rather than 20 arguments. And necessarily in the 20, there's a few that are not good or are just secondary. I'm also impressed by people who are selective in their arguments. Now, I know you have a client behind who say, well, why did you not say this? Why didn't you not say that? And maybe sometimes you have to make alternative arguments or subalternative arguments, but it's somehow less effective. But of course you have to have to be sure that your arguments are good if you're selective, but that is important. In hearings, the drafting is important, that you're a good drafter plays a role. In hearings, all of this actually goes to oral submissions as well. What I find important in hearings is for watch the tribunal, listen to the tribunal's questions, comments, watch their body language. There's a lot that you can learn about where the arbitrators have difficulties, what they do not understand, or where they're not sure, where they have doubts. If you capture this during the hearing, then you will be much more effective in your oral and in your post-hearing briefs. I was very impressed once by counsel who was a very senior advocate, and he left to his younger partners all the facts and all the technical stuff. And at the end, in his closing statement in 20 minutes, he just took one after the other all the questions I had on my mind and gave answers. I'm not saying these were the right answers, but obviously he had understood where the difficulties were, and I thought that was very helpful. And it was certainly, it doesn't mean that he will win or lose or so, that's not the point. But his arguments were well understood, and that, so listening and watching is something we don't learn actually. We learn how to write, we learn how to speak, but we don't learn how to listen. And that's an important skill as well, in arbitration, yeah.
Thank you, Professor Gabriel. Professor Carmona, would you like to add something?
Okay, so Fabi, 30 seconds to say goodbye.
Thank you, Professor. Professor Gabriel, it's an honor to have you here, especially because you are a role model for myself. You unfortunately didn't have one, but I'm glad and happy that you are one for myself. I had already the opportunity to see a few classes from you, and you playing a role model as an arbitrator in a workshop from ICCA, and I could take from those experiences some of your humanity and the way you address to people and the issues. And that was something that I learned a lot. So thank you very much. And today was another opportunity that was really good. Thank you.
Thank you for thanking me.
Directly from New York, where he's studying right now.
Yeah, thanks for Professor Carmona. Professor Gabriel, it was amazing. It was not an interview, but a real class. Thank you so much. I hope you have also enjoyed. See you.
Professor Gabriele just echoes my colleague's words. It's not every day that we have the chance to speak with some experienced arbitrator as you. And we learn from the books, we learn from the classes, but we learn a lot from personal experiences. Such great practitioners as you. Thanks a lot.
It's hard to be the last one, but I just would like to highlight all of the words from my colleagues. It's such an honor to have you today. And we take your piece of advice for, I don't know, years and years since today. It's really, really good to follow your tips. And we hope to see you soon, maybe as an arbitrator or as an opposing counsel, who knows. Thank you.
Thanks to you.
Really, a wonderful opportunity, a real masterclass, and we enjoyed it a lot. And I look forward to meeting you in Switzerland or in Brazil as soon as we are free to travel again. So let's hope for the best. Okay.
Thank you so much. This was a real pleasure for me, and I do hope that I can see you in person in a not too distant future, and I would be very happy to come back to Brazil. So thanks to all of you and to all those who are listening, of course, as well.
Thank you very much.
Goodbye.